Hi, I'm Ken Mingis. This is Mingis on Tech. This is what I'm jokingly calling our transportation edition. I've got Mike Degonia and Lucas here. Lucas is back for a return engagement. Today I want to talk about drones and about automakers in Silicon Valley. There's a lot that's been going on with drones over the last few months. You may recall one landed on the White House lawn. One landed behind a skier that was being tracked by a TV station recently. The FAA is regulating them now, or not regulating them, but at least asking people to register their drones, and I think some 180,000 people in the U.S. have done that. So I wanted to ask Mike to stop by because he's been flying drones for 2 years. He's gotten some phenomenal footage for us for some videos and reviews that we've done. And I just wanted to ask Mike, you know, what is it about drones right now that you know, makes them apparently the gift du jour?
Well, we know that drones make it easy to capture video and images from perspectives that you just normally couldn't get.
On high, up high.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay.
And there are two primary reasons, as far as I'm concerned, that makes drones so popular. The first is they're cost effective. There are drones for a variety of budgets. Whether you're an amateur or a professional, there is a drone with a budget.
Okay, well, let me ask you. Okay, so, I mean, I don't have a drone. I'm hoping. You know, I didn't get one for Christmas this year, Alex. But, all right, so what's the price range? If I want to get a decent drone that I can get some cool footage with and isn't going to break the bank, what's the starting price
range? You're looking at $400 to $500.
Okay.
And that goes up to thousands and thousands of dollars. But the cost of entry opens up aerial photography to, like I said, both professionals and amateurs without spending that much. I mean, $400 or $500 for aerial footage,
yeah,
that's not too much to ask.
Okay, let me ask, okay, so the difference between, say, a $500 drone and a $3,000 drone, we're talking like what, the ability to shoot 4K video or
Well, these
controls?
Days 4K video is available on even the low-end drones. So
okay.
That, I mean, obviously the more money you spend, the better
the video you can take, the better.
Yeah, the more flying time, the better the video quality. Okay. So for instance, you can have a $500 drone, let's say the Phantom, DJI just dropped their prices.
Okay.
And so you can get some really decent footage and images for really cheap, for, like I said, maybe $400 or $500.
Is DJI, are they like the drone company? I mean, are there other drone companies out there? Are they pretty much the leader right now?
I think DJI is the leader. They have some great products at, you know, great price points. And not only that, but they've been in the market for so many years now that their products have a level of polish.
Okay.
That is just
Would evident. They be like the Apple of drones right now? Are they that polished and do they know what they're doing?
They're good. They're good. Okay. You know, the drone market is such that there are so many players coming in that any...
Because it's hot. Exactly.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's so, you know, I guess cheap to make that anybody can come in. But as far as I'm concerned, you get a really good price and performance ratio with the DJI products.
So so basically 2016 is the year if you want a drone, you should probably think about finally committing to it. They're easy enough to fly now that, I mean, when I had an RC helicopter that I kept flying into walls and, you know, it was almost impossible to control that thing.
Right. That's one of the factors of the drone's popularity these days, the fact that you can take it out of the box and fly it without much flight experience. And that, in concert with price, really opens up again that aerial photography market to people that have just been shut out before.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll tell you, my friend recently got a drone, and the very first flight that he took it on, he landed it in the palm of his hand. And this is a large drone.
And he never flown one before.
And that's how good the microprocessors have become in the GPS systems. He took it up 200 feet, got this beautiful, you know, sky view of his neighborhood. You can program it to follow you around. So he's got a boat, and he literally programmed it just to follow him around the lake. And it followed him around the lake. And we're planning on going skiing.
Now,
and
what happens if Mr. Drone is following you around? You're boating around the lake or whatever. And how long will a drone fly before it runs out of battery power?
Well, it depends. It depends on the drone. We have between 15 and 30 minutes. I'm actually testing two drones, and it's 15 to 20 minutes on one set, and the other has 30 minutes of flight time.
All right. So what happens if the drone is flying around Lucas's friend on the boat on the lake, and 20 minutes goes by, and it starts to run out? Does it just crash?
It should alert you. It definitely should alert you.
Give you a warning.
But a lot of drones have a failsafe, which allows it to return back to either where it started from or where the remote control is currently located.
So if you've moved around since you launched it, it'll either come back to where you are now, right, or it'll go back to where you were
right
when
before
it took off.
Right, and that depends on the drone. That depends on their settings.
Okay, Lucas, I didn't mean to interrupt there, but no, so how
okay.
did so he was he's got this one that's following him around.
And yeah, he had some issues with it at first. When he first purchased it, it didn't have a camera, so he bought a GoPro, stuck it on a what do they call the gimbal,
yeah,
which is remarkable. I mean, yeah, this.
But
thing,
that's how you get all the 360 degree up and down video,
exactly,
right?
Exactly.
Well, that's how you get stable video for sure. Right.
Okay.
Oh, it's remarkable. I mean, he was showing me, you could see like one propeller being pushed around by the wind.
Yeah.
But the camera was perfectly still. The okay. gimbal just is, it's a remarkable.
Was his a quadcopter? Is that the common? They're all four. Is that for stability?
Right.
Yes, for stability. And the lower end models of the quadcopter format has become the most popular. But once you start reaching the multi-$1,000 range, you start getting.
Can you have more than quad?
Oh, yeah, these eight props.
An octa quad, octa whatever. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Okay. One other question I wanted to ask you before we move on to Detroit and the automakers. You had mentioned you were testing two drones right now. I think you said one of them is a selfie drone.
It's a selfie drone.
What the hell's a selfie drone?
Fair enough.
Does the world need selfie drones? Okay, anyway, go ahead.
It's exactly. It's the product I'm looking at is the Sim 2 from or the Dragonfly from Sim 2.
Okay.
And it's a portable unit. It folds up into a nice a portable package, and it's controlled via watch. And like your friend's drone, its entire premise is to kind of get out of the way. If you want to film, 15, 20 minutes of whatever activity that you're doing,
yeah,
you basically launch this drone, use the watch. It has some pre-programmed buttons.
It's not an Apple Watch. The watch comes with the drone. It's a specific transmitter or whatever.
Exactly.
Okay.
And then the watch has some basic commands as well as information, yeah, about the flight, as well as the drone and satellites connected to things like that. And the drone actually tethers itself to a GPS module.
Okay.
And then you send it in the air, and it basically follows you
wherever
around.
Wherever
you go, just like your friends.
On the boat, or if you're running, or what about if you're driving? How fast can these things go?
Some drones can get up. I believe the Inspire gets up above 35, maybe 40 miles per
okay.
hour.
I've not clocked, quite CIA level, but damn,
right,
not bad.
I've clocked my own Phantom 3 at 30, 35 miles per hour.
Okay.
And the Inspire, the high-end drone from DJI, is much more geared toward that professional, and as also
okay, that's what you get for money,
right?
More
that's
money.
Exactly it. But the thing with the Inspire is it allows two people to control the unit, one for flying and the other for controlling the camera,
the photography.
Right.
Okay. So that's the selfie drone is one of the ones you're evaluating. What's the other one?
The other is the Chroma 4K from
okay.
Horizon Hobby.
Okay.
And that is more of a direct DJI competitor.
Okay.
It does a few things that the DJIs don't. For instance, the DJI remote control requires that you bring your own tablet or bring your own phone,
yeah,
which displays the flight information as well as the video that
yeah.
you get from the flight. But that's a separate unit. So, I mean, I've inadvertently been running, and inadvertently the phone almost fell off.
Okay.
With the Chroma 4K, the touchscreen display is built right into the remote control.
Okay.
So that's one less component you have to kind of worry about.
Is that the sort of technology that will eventually probably trickle down to like less expensive models?
All technology
over the
trickles
next,
down.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
So this is, the longer I wait, the better off I'm going
to
be.
With anything, though.
Yeah.
You just have to jump in. But now is a good time to just jump in if you're interested in aerial photography.
Cool.
And what's really nice, bringing it back to the Horizon Hobby drone, the Chroma also has different flight modes. So it makes it suitable for, there's the follow me mode and the track me mode and things like that. But it also has a beginner mode, which kind of puts
that would be
a,
me.
Right, which it puts a circle around you so you can't fly the drone into yourself.
Okay,
but
good.
It also puts a larger geofence around the area so you can only bring it a certain distance or a certain height, which is great for beginners. But the very same drone has different modes that appeal to experts.
Okay.
So there's an advanced flight mode that turns off all the sensors. So
you're on your own.
Yeah, exactly.
And you better not be near an airport, right?
Right. And what that does is allows for more, what turning off the sensors allows it for more agile, more acrobatic flights, mm-hmm. and you can do flips and
cool.
all sorts
okay.
of somersaults with these things. So
wow.
the Chroma drone is nice because because it just encompasses a wide variety of experience. And the camera is very nice, so you get some great images and great video, which you'll see when I come out.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. Mike is reviewing these for Computer World now. We'll have his full video review up soon, so basically stay tuned. I want to get the full report. Lucas, let me switch to you, because one of the things you've written about recently that I found really interesting is the growing connection between Detroit and Silicon Valley.
Right.
With Detroit really basically setting up R&D headquarters out in California. What's going on there? Are cars becoming more like computers, and that's what they're doing?
That's exactly what it is. The hardware is becoming, like computers, the hardware is becoming commoditized. So the engine, the computer chips, the mechanics of a car are becoming,
everybody has an engine and four wheels. Yeah.
Right, exactly. And they're really becoming software defined, like your computer, like phones, like in enterprises, software defined storage or software defined servers or software defined data center. The same thing is happening to cars. And so they're going logically to the place where software is mainly developed, and that's Silicon Valley. So they're partnering with what you would consider the more typical software developers out there. Apple, which is on the West Coast, but also has offices out there, and Google and other companies, in order to develop this software. And it's almost a necessity, too, because we've talked about CarPlay and Android Auto, which is going to be a necessity in cars. They're going
you
to
think
have
all cars will have probably both,
have
I assume.
To. They're going to have to. It's simply satisfying consumer demand. We all, most of us, have smartphones, and the vast majority of the smartphones are Android.
Or Apple.
Apple.
Yeah.
So they're going to have to appease their customers. And what's interesting about that is that right now it's co-opetition, it's cooperative competition. But eventually Apple and Google are going to be in direct competition with Harman and other and auto manufacturers who are creating infotainment systems. And virtually they're taking them over.
Isn't this sort of a reaction too to the fact that automakers, when they've been doing technology in the past, there was such a long lead time? In 2010, the car you bought that might have a nav screen or something like that was really using 2006 or 2007 technology. And I mean, I saw a story literally just yesterday that the new C-Class or E-Class Mercedes would have more advanced technology than the brand new S-Class because they got it, it's a little later in the production cycle. So you've got a car that costs tens of thousands of dollars less than the top of the line Mercedes. It's got more the newest technology, basically.
Right. And what auto manufacturers have been looking at for a decade or more is, they haven't gone there yet, but they're getting closer to it, a modular system. So systems that during the manufacturing or the development cycle, they can be updated as they go along in that development cycle. Prior to that, the development cycle was 4 or 5 years long.
Yeah.
And so by the time you got the car out to
it was
the
ancient.
Public,
it was ancient.
The technology
would you
was
buy
ancient.
A 5-year-old computer now?
No,
I mean, really.
I mean, that's just it.
Right.
And that's why you were getting cars with these infotainment systems that just seemed archaic, and they were slow, and they didn't offer a lot of capabilities.
Yeah.
But slowly but surely, the market is starting to transition to modular systems that are going to allow them to update just before it comes to market.
Would something like CarPlay and Android Auto be along those lines? Because I'm going to update my phone regularly. So CarPlay will be updated, and I have a car now that has CarPlay.
Right.
So I have, whenever I have an updated phone, I basically have the latest technology for my car, right?
And that's the other side to the coin, is that once your informatics system basically becomes a mobile phone, it's going to be able to access all the same applications that your phone has.
Yeah.
And that's where the competition comes in, because the auto manufacturers are trying to create the latest and greatest infotainment systems and applications for you to use. The phone manufacturer is saying, hey, just link your phone with your car and you've got all these new apps and you can download as many of the new ones.
Makes it easier on the manufacturers. One final question. So in terms of what's going on in Silicon Valley, are developers out there being hired by the automakers? Are automakers partnering with the local companies, Apple, Google, whatever.
Yeah.
Or is it sort of a combination of the two?
It's a combination of the two, but automakers are definitely going after the former software executives in Silicon Valley, and
they want people who know how to manage these things and run these technology companies.
Absolutely.
In-house.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a shift going on, and as I said, it's a shift to software-defined automobiles and trucks.
Great. Okay. Cool. Yeah. Very interesting. Thanks a lot, guys. I really appreciate it. Absolutely. I now know what I need to know about drones. I now know what's going on with Silicon Valley and why my car may come from Silicon Valley someday, or at least the brains of it.
Yeah.
That's a wrap. That'll do it for us for this show. Thanks a lot for watching.